coming to the structure of monocot stem, the monocot stem is covered with the outermost layer called as what? Epidermis. So above the epidermis we can see the presence of a cuticle made up of suberin. Okay, so this will impervious to movement of water. Cuticle is made up of suberin, which is impervious to movement of the water. Okay, next to the epidermis we can see the presence of a second layer called as hypodermis, made up of sclerenchyma tissue. Next, below this hypodermis we can see the presence of chlorenchyma. So what do you mean by chlorenchyma? The parenchyma cells, if they possess chloroplast in them, then we will call it as what? Chlorenchyma. Okay, so here we can able to observe the scattered vascular bundles. That is a special characteristic of a monocot stem. The vascular bundles are scattered like this. See, you can see here the vascular bundles are scattered. Okay, vascular bundles are scattered and smaller vascular bundles are near the border, outermost region, whereas big vascular bundles are near the pith region. Okay, so the vascular bundles are covered by a sclerenchymatous cells. So next, so inside the each vascular bundle we can see the presence of a protoxylem as well as metaxylem, and then a cavity called as lysogenic cavity. Okay, so this is a cavity called as lysogenous cavity. So each vascular bundles are covered by a sclerenchymatous bundle sheath formation. Okay, so this is the structure of monocot stem. Next, so coming to the structure of a dicot stem, so we can see the again the same outermost layer called as what? Epidermis, with multicellular stem hair. We are not supposed to call it as a stem hair, we have to call it as what? So trichome. We can see the formation of multicellular trichome. Okay, so next to the epidermis we can see the formation of a second layer called as what? Hypodermis. So the cortex is divided into hypodermis and cortical layers. Okay, so this is the hypodermis made up of collenchyma cells. Again, a special characteristic of a dicot stem, it possesses collenchyma cells in the hypodermal region. Next to the collenchyma we can see the formation of 2 to 3 layers of cortical cells made up of what? Parenchyma. Okay, so the collenchyma, parenchyma, endodermis together form the cortex. Okay, so the collenchyma is about what? Hypodermis region, and next to the hypodermis region is the cortical cells made up of parenchyma and other cells here. Okay, so next to the cortex we can see the formation of endodermis here. So this is called as what? Endodermis. So thick layer of, single layer of endodermal cells are formed next below the cortex region. And the pericytal region is again made up of what? Sclerenchyma tissue or sclerenchyma cells. Next, so we can see the conjoint collateral type of vascular bundle. This is conjoint collateral type of vascular bundle. In that collateral also, this is open type, whereas in the monocot stem it is closed because there is no cambium between the xylem and phloem. Okay, so there is no cambium between the xylem and phloem, hence it is conjoint collateral closed, and this is conjoint collateral open. Why it is called as conjoint collateral? Because xylem and phloem are found in the same radius. Okay, next, in between the xylem and phloem we can see the presence of a cambium tissue. So that's why it is said to be what? Conjoint collateral open type of vascular bundles. Okay. And metaxylem is facing towards outside, protoxylem is facing towards pith region. Then the condition of the vascular bundle is said to be endarch. Okay. So this is the structure of the dicot stem. So many questions may appear on this. Okay. Next we will go to the structure of the leaf. So this is the structure of a dicot leaf and this is the structure of a monocot leaf. Okay. So coming to the structure of the dicot leaf, it is called as dorsiventral leaf. Why? Because this distribution of stomata is not equal. It is less or very less on the dorsal surface and more on the ventral surface. Okay. So that's why the dicot leaf is said to be what? Dorsiventral leaf. Whereas monocot leaf is called as isobilateral leaf. Why? Because the distribution of stomata is equal on both dorsal side as well as on ventral side. Okay. Coming to the structure of the dicot leaf, it consisting of two epidermal region. Outermost dorsal surface epidermal region as well as ventral surface epidermal region. The dorsal surface epidermal region is called as what? Adaxial epidermis, whereas ventral surface epidermis is called as abaxial epidermis. Okay, we can see more number of stomata distribution in abaxial epidermis, not in the adaxial epidermis. So this is a stomatal apparatus seen more in case of abaxial epidermis. So coming to the innermost structure, next to the epidermis is the mesophyll cells, which are spread throughout the structure of the what? Dicot leaf. And the mesophyll cells have been distributed into two types depending upon their appearance. Okay. So the mesophyll cells, which are column in their appearance, long columnar shape. So such mesophyll cells are called as what? Pellucid mesophyll cells made up of parenchyma only. Pellucid mesophyll cells made up of parenchyma. Whereas the one more mesophyll cells are that is they are appearing in the sponge shape and they are irregularly distributed with more intercellular spaces. Whereas here we will not find any intercellular space, but in the appearance of spongy mesophyll parenchyma cells, we can see the formation of intercellular space. Okay, so that is called as what? Air cavity. Next, coming to the vascular bundles. Again, the vascular bundles is made up of what? Xylem and phloem elements. Xylem and phloem elements, which is again covered by parenchymatous cells. Next to the tissue, vascular tissue, we can see the formation of a special cells called as bundle sheath cells. Okay, which gives protection for the vascular bundles. This is a characteristic of only dicot leaf. Okay. So this is the appearance of a structure of a dicot leaf. Next, coming to the structure of the monocot leaf, here also the epidermis is divided into adaxial and abaxial, but the distribution of stomata is equal on both the epidermal layers. Okay, next, coming to the mesophyll cells, the mesophyll cells is not differentiated into pellucid and spongy parenchyma mesophyll cells, whereas all are spongy parenchyma cells which are tightly packed with no intercellular space. Okay, next, coming to vascular bundles, again same type of vascular bundles is seen here also in both the cases, that is metaxylem, protoxylem, and that which is covered by what? Phloem elements. So these blue color structures are called phloem and red color ring like structures are called xylem here also. Okay, so next, so we can see the formation of sclerenchyma tissues as a pouches like this. Yeah, patches, not pouches, like a patches. Sclerenchyma patches can be absorbed on both the epidermal surfaces, below the epidermal surfaces. Okay, so next, here in the adaxial epidermis we can see the special presence of a special type of cells called as bulliform cells. Again, that is the characteristic feature of a monocotyledon, presence of bulliform cells or the characteristic feature of a monocotyledon. Certain cells will become empty and when they absorb water they will become touch, okay, and it helps in exposing the leaf surface to be air. Okay, so when the water level is low then it will allow curling of the leaf to avoid the stress. Okay, so the main function performing by the bulliform cells, presence of bulliform cells is a special characteristic of monocot leaf. Here presence of bundle sheath cells is a characteristic of a dicot leaf. Okay, so we have finished with the all the structure, transverse section of both stem monocot, dicot, root monocot, dicot, and leaf monocot and dicot. Okay, next concept of this chapter is the secondary growth in plants. So when the plants grow in height, so and when it reach a certain period, then it will start producing its in start increasing its width. Okay, so at that time the in green color part of the plant stem, so called stem, will turn to a hard brownish color wood. Okay, so it will get converted as a wood. The soft green color stem will increase in its width or increase in its girth and get converted as a hard part, brownish part, called as what? Wood. So this is what we will call it as what? Secondary growth. So the secondary growth is absent in monocot stem, whereas it's seen in dicot stem. Why? Because the in order to formation of the secondary growth, there should be a cambium. But in case of monocot stem, there is no cambium in between the two vascular bundle. Hence, it is called as what? Conjoined collateral close type, isn't it? Okay, so here in case of dicot stem we can see the formation or presence of a cambium in between the xylem and phloem. So this cambium involves in the formation of a new cells which result in the growth of the stem in widthwise. Okay, so that meristematic tissue involves in secondary growth is called as what? Vascular cambium or cork cambium. Like this, we will call it as cambium. Okay, so the cambium is found, meristematic tissue found in between the xylem and phloem. Then such type of the tissue will involve in the formation of new cells. So that's why secondary growth is seen only in dicot stem but not in monocot stem. Okay, so this is the structure of a secondary growth that occurs in dicot stem. Okay, so here first dicot stem activity or secondary growth in dicot stem takes place in two processes, that is formation of cambium ring, activity of cambium ring. Here you can see, so this is a vascular bundles, polyarch vascular bundles. Okay, next the green color circle like structure what we are observing is the cambium found in between the vascular bundle, that is xylem and phloem. So this cambium is called as what? Intravascular cambium. Intra means inside, in between the xylem and phloem. So this produces this cambium found inside the vascular bundles produces new cells, which the newly formed cells will move outside the vascular bundle and form a ring-like structure like this. This is how the formation of cambium ring takes place. Okay, so here it will start and this diagram, it has been completed, formation of cambial ring, and this one the vascular cambium formed in between the two vascular bundle is called as interfascicular cambium. The vascular bundle found inside the the cambium found inside the vascular bundle is called as intrafascicular, whereas the cambium found in between the two vascular bundles are called as intervesicular cambium. Clear? So this is the difference between intravesicular cambium and intervesicular cambium. Intra means inside, inter means between the two. Okay, so inter and intravesicular cambium join to form a ring called as vascular cambium ring. Okay, so this vascular cambium ring again become active and produces cells both on outer side as well as on inner side. Okay, so here you can see. So this is how the new cambium ring produces new cells both towards outer side as well as towards inner side. So the formation of more cells is more toward inner side when compared with the outer sides. Okay. So next, it leads to the formation of what? Secondary xylem and secondary phloem elements. The cambium ring produces new cells both towards outer side as well as towards inner side. So it which result in the formation of secondary xylem and secondary phloem. Okay, so the cells which are formed towards inner side, towards pith region, forms the secondary xylem, and the cells which are formed towards outer side, cortex side, forms the secondary phloem. Okay, so after this, we can see the formation of a phellem, phellotum. I'll come to this, what is phellem and phellotum. Okay, is that clear? So this is how the secondary growth takes place in dicot plant. So which result in the formation or increase in the girth of the plant or width of the plant. See, this is how the first before secondary growth, the stem size will look like this. And after secondary growth, it will increase in its width from here to here. Yeah. Oh, next, we'll go for the next one. So overview of a secondary growth, what I have told till now. So this is there in the slide. You can take a screenshot. Okay. So secondary growth add width to older areas of the stem and roots. That is no longer growing in length. That are no longer growing in length. Okay. So typically stem have much more secondary growth than roots. Which will exhibit more secondary growth? Stem than the roots. Okay. So next, which is the tissue which involves in the production of secondary xylem and secondary phloem? Vascular cambium. I have shown you in the diagram, isn't it? Okay. Next, the vascular cambium itself form the cells in cortex and procambium. Okay. Next, in roots, pericycle cells are also involved. Where is the pericycle? Where you can find the presence of pericycle? Below the endodermis region. Okay. So that is also involved in case of roots. Okay, next, cork cambium, so called phellogen, form initially from parenchymal cells in the cortex and sometimes in the primary cell. Okay, so see, as new cells are formed in the innermost region, pressure exerted, where it is taking place, this growth is taking place inside the endodermis region. Okay, endodermis, pericycle, inside that we will form the vascular tissue. As the new cells are formed inside the pit, the size will keep on increasing. Due to this, pressure exerted on the cortex cells. Okay, pressure exerted on the cortex cells. These cortex cells again start producing new cells. Why this will have to produce new cells? Because as the pressure exerted by increasing in the width of the pith region, inner regions of the tissue, so then outermost cells will break off. In order to overcome or in order to withdraw the outermost cells, in order to take back the vanished outermost cells, this cortex region cells become active. Okay, the cambium found inside the cortex region is called as what? Cork cambium. Okay, the cambium found inside the cortex region is called as what? Cork cambium. This cork cambium again become active and produces new cells both towards outer side and towards inner side. Okay. So, the cork cambium produces new dermal tissue which eventually replaces the epidermis formed by protoderm. Okay. So this is what about the secondary growth, how it will take place. Next, different types of wood as being formed during the secondary growth. So next, which are those one? See here, periderm, which consists of both core cambium or secondary cortex. See, as I told you, this core cambium produces new cells both towards outer side and inner side. So the cells which are formed by the core cambium is less towards outer side and more towards inner side. So the outer side cells formed by the core cambium is called as what? Core phellem. What we will call it as core phellem. And the innermost cells which are formed is called as secondary cortex or phelloderm. Secondary cortex or phelloderm. So core cambium, that is phellogen, core phellem, secondary cortex or what? Phelloderm together formed as a periderm. All together we will call it as what? Periderm. So many questions may appear on this. What is phellem? What is phelloderm? What is phellogen? What is core? What is core cambium? What is secondary cortex? From which part of the cells the secondary cortex has been formed? Like this, many questions may appear on this question. First you have to clear the concept, then you can very easily answer such type of questions. Okay, here periderm constitute what? Core cambium and secondary cortex. Here, so what is core cambium? The cambium found inside the cortex region is called as what? Core cambium. It is also called in one more name, that is phelogen. As the pressure exerted by the new cells formed in the pith region, so soon as afterwards the cortex will also get excited and some of the cell may lost in the epidermal region. In order to overcome the loss or in order to compensate the lost cells, the cambium found in the secondary cortex or cortex region, it become active and produces new cells both towards outer side as well as towards inner side. The newly formed cells towards outer side, towards the epidermis, is called as core phellem. Okay, so it's there here, core phellem. And the newly formed cells towards the inner side, towards the endodermis or towards the pith region, is called as what? Secondary cortex or phelloderm. All together, all the three, it is called as periderm. Is it clear now? Okay. Next, so many types of wood has been formed. This is vascular cambium and these two altogether called as what? Bark. Okay. So what is bark? It is a non-technical term used to rectify or note the outermost layer of the epidermal tissues found on the woody stem. Okay. Next, this is called secondary phloem, and two types of wood has been formed here, heartwood and sapwood, early wood or late wood. Okay, so early wood or late wood, heartwood and sapwood, spring wood or autumn wood. Like this, many types of wood may come here. Okay, so many types of wood we have discussed now. Okay, next, so what is sapwood then? Also referred as alburnum. Okay, so it is the living outermost portion of the woody stem, branch or root of a plant where sap flows. It's usually lighter in color. So it is usually what? Lighter in color. Okay, so cells contain more water and lack darkly stained chemical substance commonly found in heart. This is called sapwood, which is lighter in color, and this is called heartwood, which is darker in color. Okay, sapwood perform adding support to the tree, transportation of nutrients and xylem sap. So main function performing by the sapwood. It is also called as alburnum. Okay, next, heartwood is also called as duramen. It is dead inner wood of a stem. Dead inner wood of a stem. See, this is heartwood and this is sapwood. Okay, these contain substance that make it dark. So which are the substance will make the heartwood dark here? Tannin, resin, gum, ergastic substances like this make the wood hard. Okay, so it is mechanically strong and resist to decay. So that's why hardwood is mostly selected to prepare or to make the furnitures. Why? Because they have the resistance to alkali materials as well as strong acid resistant, as well as it have the capacity to resist the microorganisms and termites. Termites get them. So idrinda yen madutte protection kodutte. So that's why hardwood is preferred for preparing furnitures. Okay, so the main function of hardwood is to support the tree. And so the bark is also differentiated into outer bark and inner. Okay, so this is about types of wood: hardwood, sapwood, springwood, autumn wood. The springwood means the form wood which is formed in the spring season, early part of the plant life. Okay, so which wider cavities, wider xylem cavities. So this is this involves in more conduction of waters. So this is called as springwood. Or next wood is early wood. Then it another wood is there, that is autumn wood, or it is also called as late wood. Autumn wood or late wood, it will develops in the later part of the plant life in the autumn season with wider, not wider, narrow xylem cavities, with narrow xylem cavities. Okay, so these are all the information regarding the anatomy of the flowering. We have discussed in detail so that it will helpful for you people to answer the question. Okay, so next I'll go with the discussion of some of the questions what I have selected for you people. Okay, so in the first question, polenchyma constitutes the hypodermis in. Okay, so we have discussed now itself that the hypodermis of the dicot stem is made up of what? Polenchyma cells, which is a characteristic feature of a dicot stem, isn't it? So that's why we can easily go for an answer, that is dicot stem. So which are options what we have given for you here? Monocot root, dicot stem, dicot root, monocot stem. All the four options has been given here. But if we know the answer correctly, that hypodermis of the dicot stem only made up of polenchyma tissue or polenchyma cells, tissue cells, then we can easily opt the option number B. There is a correct options for question number 1. Is it clear? Oh, next. So we have discussed the concept in detail so that it will become very easy for the answering the questions. Okay, next. The cells bordering stoma are called. So why it is going very fastly, I don't know. Okay, so the cells which is guarding the stoma or bordering the stoma, or the cells which are found very next outermost covering of the stomatal pore is called as what? Guard cells. So hence, since it is guarding, they are called as what? Guard cells. Okay, so which is the correct option here? Option B, again guard cells. Okay, next. See, in pteridophytes, so called ferns, the vascular bundles are described as, in pteridophytes, so called ferns, the vascular bundles are described as, means here they are asking about the vascular bundles found in the pteridophytes. Okay, so this is the vascular bundles type what have discussed: conjoint, collateral, closed, open, bicollateral, amphibasal, amphicribrible, and radial. So this type of vascular bundles, what pteridophytes will have this one, amphibasal type of vascular bundles. Okay, so where xylem is found in the outermost ring, whereas phloem is found in the innermost. Okay, so such a type of vascular bundles are called as what? Concentric vascular bundles in that amphibase. Amphicribrible means xylem will present in the innermost region, phloem surrounds in outermost region. Okay, so this one, amphibasal type of vascular bundle, is seen in pteridophytes. Okay, next option. Which one is the correct option for question number 3 here? Option D. Clear? Next. Piliferous layer in root is, it's the question. Piliferous layer in root is. So piliferous layer of root is made up of what? Which among the following option? Epidermis, pericycle, cortex and endodermis. So the option is epidermis. Why? We have to know the reason. Because the piliferous layer is a part of epidermis of the root which contains root hairs. What's the piliferous layer means? It is a part of the epidermis of the root which contains root hairs. Okay. So this layer is present over a region of 400 millimeter after the root. It is present above the root tip after 400 millimeter of the ridge. Okay. So the piliferous layer is shed away to expose the hypodermis under. Next, it also functions in the uptake of water under the nutrients. Main function of the piliferous layer is the uptake of water under the nutrients. So, which is the correct option? The piliferous layer is made up of epidermis of the root, not of pericycle, cortex and endodermis. So, the correct option is epidermis, option A. Okay. So, somewhat different types of questions. Next, commercially import cotton fibers. Which is the correct option? Options what have given are woody fibers of the root, bark fibers of stem, epidermal hairs of seeds, phloem fibers of the root. Okay. So what is the option here? Epidermal hairs of the seeds. Why? Why can't all the three options? Why is the option C is correct? See the reason for this question. So this is because the fiber wall of cotton are not lignified. Okay, the fiber balls of cotton are not lignified and it does not actually possess the true characteristic features of fibers. So that's why commercially imported cotton fibers are epidermal hairs of the seeds. Okay, cotton seeds, epidermal seeds are commercially imported, not imported, imported. Okay, so each seed contains 10,000 to 20,000 hairs and the ripened hair can twist and cling and are useful for spinning and unripe hair. So this is the main function of the what? Cotton hairs. Each seed contains 10,000 to 20,000 hairs and the ripened hairs can twist and cling and are useful for spinning and unripe hair. Spinning means formation of cotton threads. So that's why epidermal hairs of seeds in case of cotton is the correct option for question number 5. Okay. So you can take a screenshot of each PPT so that you can refer later. Okay. Next, question number 6. Undifferentiated ground tissue is present in the stem of. Undifferentiated ground tissue is present in the stem of sunflower, Pisum, mice, cucurbita. Okay. So here, what is undifferentiated ground tissue means? So we can see the undifferentiated ground tissue after the epidermis, the next cortical cells, endodermis, pericycle, it's not there in case of monocot stem, isn't it? We have discussed the structure now itself. The monocot stem does not have any differentiated corticals region, endodermis, pericycle like that. Okay, so which is the characteristic feature of a what? Monocot stem. And coming to the options they have given here, that is sunflower, pisum, maize, cucurbita. Except maize, all the three are dicot plants. Okay, only one is the monocot plant here, which is one maize. So that's why maize shows many vascular bundles scattered toward the ground tissue, which is not differentiated into cortex, central cylindrical like structure, as in monocot, as it is a monocot. Okay. So that's why maize is the correct option for the question number 6, option C, maize. Okay. Next, question number 7. Next question. Which of the following fibers is not a plant product? Which are the options they have given us? Hemp, cotton, flax, silk. We know that all the three are plant product except silk. Okay, so why? What is silk then? What is it is made up of? It's a natural protein fibers which forms of, which can be woven into textiles. Okay, some forms of which can be woven into textiles, which preparation of saris, silk cloths. Okay, silk saris, silk cloths, silk items. The best silk is obtained from cocoons of the larvae of mulberry silkworm, Bombyx mori. Okay, reshme goodu. Goodu inda naven tagoltivi, silk tagoltivi. It is not a plant product, it is an animal product. So that's why silk is not obtained from plant fibers. So which is the correct option here? Option D, silk is the correct option for question number 7. Okay, next. For the next question, question number 8, double-shaped god cells are found in submerged leaf, dicot petiole, grass leaf blade. Okay, so the correct option for this question, we can easily make out by looking the diagram. Why? Because the double-shaped god cells is a characteristic feature of what? Monocot plant. See, leaves. Monocot leaf. And presence of the guard, bean-shaped guard cells is the characteristic feature of a dicot leaf. Here, submerged leaf and submerged leaves, the stomata has been submerged into the mesophyses. And not like that, that one. Dicot petiole. Petiole, when compared to the leaf, it will, we will see more guard cells or more stomata on the leaves, not on the petiole. Okay. Next, dicot leaf, we have bean shape, not the dumbbell shape. What is this green leaf blade then? Bean leaf, grass leaf blade is nothing but the leaf of a grass, which is a monocot leaf, okay, which is the best example for the dumbbell shaped stomach, god cells. Okay, so that's why, which is the correct option here? Option D, grass leaf blade. Grass leaf blade is the correct option for the question number 8, because the dumbbell shaped guard cells are found in monocot leaf. Grass is an example for monocot leaf. Clear? Next, question number 9, which type of thickening is found in protoxylem? Now I've shown you in the this one, differences between the protoxylem and metaxylem. That, so the protoxylem exhibit annular or spiral thickenings, whereas the metaxylem exhibit reticulate, pitted and scaliform thickenings. So that's why, which is the correct option here for the question number B? Spiral or annular. If annular, if they have given like annular, then annular will be the correct answer. If they given spiral, then it is the correct option in case of protoxylem. If instead of protoxylem, if they have given metaxylem here, then it may be reticulate or pitted or scaly form. Clear? Okay, which is the correct option? Question number 9. Option B, spiral type of thickening is seen. Next. Question number 10. The innermost layer of cortex is called. Innermost layer of the cortex is called as what? Endodermis, made up of a barrel-shaped, single layer of barrel-shaped cells which show radial and tangential thickening. Alba, which is called as Casparian strips, made up of suberin, which are impermeable to the movement of water. Yeah? So, which is the correct option? Option A, endodermis. Here is the reason. Clear? Next, question number 11, diarch, triarch or tetrarch vascular bundle is a characteristic feature of. What do you mean by diarch? Presence of two type vascular bundles, triarch 3, tetrarch 4. We can easily answer this question by remembering the diagram of a dicot root, isn't it? The dicot root consisting of what? Tetrarch vascular bundles. So the number of protoxylem poles in a root may be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 or 6 or more. Accordingly, they are called monarch, diarch, triarch, tetrarch and so on. So the tetrarch vascular bundle is a characteristic feature of a dicot root. Whereas in monocot, we can see presence of polyarch vascular buttons, isn't it? Okay, next is the characteristic feature of a dicot root. Next, is it clear? Question number 11, option A, dicot root, which has tetrarch vascular bundle. Question number 12, the cells which help in rolling and unrolling of leaf lamina in grasses are. Okay, so the cells which help in rolling and unrolling of leaf lamina in grass. Grass is an example of monocot cells. Okay, monocot cells. I have told you now with cells, the monocot cells have a special type of cells called as bullic form cells, isn't it? So bubble shaped epidermal cells called as bullic form cells, which are also called as what? Motor cells. Okay, so the bullic form cells are also called as motor cells, present in adaxial, not in abaxial, which helps in unfolding and folding of developing leaves, rolling or unfolding, folding or unfolding. Okay, mature leaves. Okay, in order to alternate wet and dry condition. In wet condition, it will be exposed, unrolled. Okay, in dry condition, it is rolled in order to avoid the loss of water. Okay, so which is the correct option here? Question of number 12, the correct option is motor cells. Motor cells, also called as what? Bulliform cells. Okay, next, question number 13. The inner, darker and harder portion of secondary xylem that cannot conduct water in an old dicot stem is called what? So now only we have discussed during the secondary growth. It is so called alburnum, isn't it? Alburnum. So which is the correct option? Alburnum. Next, the outer light colored functional secondary xylem or wood takes up in the conduction of water is called as sapwood or alburnum. Okay, so the inner portion of the secondary xylem which is non-functional and cannot conduct water is called as what? Heartwood or duramen. So one minute, the inner darker and harder portion of the secondary xylem that cannot conduct water. Sorry, it has been given wrong here. Make it as a duramen. Okay, the inner which cannot involve in the conduction of water is called as what? Duramen. And this is the alburnum or sapwood. And this is the duramen or so here, correct option is duramen, not alburnum. Make a correction in this. Okay. So it has been mistakenly typed as alburnum. Okay. Next. Grafting cannot be practiced in monocot plants. Grafting cannot be practiced in monocot plants. The reason for this is that, let's see the option, have very thin tissue, do not have cambium, do not have pick, have endocyte. Okay, so all are there, but they do not have cambium because monocot plants exhibit conjoint collateral close type of vascular bundles, isn't it? Conjoint collateral close type of vascular bundle is seen in monocot plants. So that's why they do not have cambium is the option. So the tissue has a regeneration capacity because of which it can form new tissues at the time of grafting. Okay, so this type of tissue is absent in monocot. So what is the grafting means? It is a type of artificial hybridization technique where the stem piece of one plant or tied with the stem piece of another plant and they are wrapped with the cellophane tape so that they have packed tightly and the cambium found in between the two stem pieces, the so-called stalk and scion, will involve in the secondary growth and produces new cells which involves in the growth of the particular plant. Okay, so which is absent in the case of monocot, hence secondary growth, so-called grafting technique, is not possible in monocot plants since they lack cambium. So they don't have game. So which is the correct option here? Option B, that is, they do not have game. Clear? Oh, next question number 14. Atactosty. Atactosty is seen in dicot stem, monocot stem, dicot root, monocot. So before answering question, we have to know what is atactosty means, isn't it? Okay, it is the type of eustachyle found in monocot in which the vascular tissue in the stem exists as scattered bundles. Okay, appearance of a scattered vascular bundles is called as what? Atactosty, which is a type of an eustachyle. Most seed plants stem possesses a vascular arrangement which has been interpreted as a derived siphonostyle and is called as a eustachyle. Okay, in most seeded plants, stem possesses a vascular arrangement which has been interpreted as a derived siphonostyle and is called as a eustachyle. But in case of a monocot stem or monocot plants, the scattered vascular bundles, appearance of a scattered vascular bundles is called as what? Atactosty. Okay, so we can see the formation of atactosty in case of monocot stem. Which is the correct option for this question? Question number 15. That is option B. What is atactosty and what is siphonosty? You have information here. Okay, go through this and it will be helpful for the other question also. Next, the rosewood tree of India is, see, rosewood tree is growing in different parts of the world. So the most important or best known rosewood tree found in India, which is one, which among the following? They have given with a scientific name, okay, Dalbergia siso, Tamarindus indica, Dalbergia latifolia, Pinus roxburgh. Okay, these are the four names of the trees they have given. Okay, among them, Dalbergia siso is known the most famous rosewood tree of India, which is commonly seen in North India. Okay, and this rosewood is called also called as North Indian rosewood or shisham. It's a fast growing, hardy. Hardy means it is very hard in appearance. Deciduous rosewood tree native to Indian subcontinent and southern Iran. Okay, so it is a large crooked tree with long leathery leaves and wheatish or pink flowers. Appearance of wheatish or pink colors flowers as well as large crooked tree with long leathery leaves is a characteristic feature of Dalbergia siso. Okay, so which is a rosewood tree of India? Clear this one? Not Dalbergia latifolia, Tamarindus indica and Pinus roxburgh, which is the one rosewood tree of India, Dalbergia siso. Okay, next question number 16, is that clear? Next question number 17, leaves grow due to the presence of, leaves will grow due to the presence of apical meristem, rib meristem, mass meristem, plate meristem. We know that apical meristem, presence of the apical meristem in the apex regions or tip regions of the leaf as well as stem or root involves in the growth of the particular parts of the plant. Okay, the apical meristem, also known as growing tip, is an undifferentiated meristematic tissue found in the buds and growing tips of root in plants. So that's why, which is the correct option here? Option A, apical meristem, not the rib meristem, mass meristem as well as the plate meristem. Yeah. 18. The central region of the root apex containing less active cells is known as. The correct option for this is periphyllum, quotient region, plerome, dermatogen. Okay. So the correct option is quotient region. So first we have to know what is quotient region means, isn't it? So the quotient region is the part of the root promeristem that contains the initials of epidermis, cortex and stele. Okay, so these cells divide less frequently as they are inactive and are present at the pole of the cortex and then what is cerebellum means? Middle layer that give rise to hypodermis, cortex and endodermis. Okay, cortex give rise to which is a part of the root promeristem and contains initial tissues of epidermis and cortex. So which is central region of the root and they are inactive. Okay, so and they are inactive or less active cells. Whereas cerebellum means middle layer which give rise to hypodermis, cortex and endodermis. Pleura means innermost layer which give rise to vascular tissue including pith. Dermatogen, outermost primary meristem of a plant or a plant pod that according to histogen theory give rise to epidermis. This involves in formation of epidermis. This involves in the formation of vascular tissue and pith. Cerebellum involves in the formation of hypodermis, cortex and endodermis. Whereas the quotient region, which is the innermost region or central region of the root apex, which is formed with a less active cell, does not involve in the formation of new tissues. Okay, so that's why, which is the correct option for question number B, quotient region. Clear? Next, question number 19. In monocot, root cap is formed from. In monocot, root cap is formed from. So, see here also it has been mistaken. Let's see the option first. Calyptrogen, dermatogen, fascicular cambium, protoderm. So, first what we will see, we know fascicular cambium. It found in between the vascular bundles. If it is found inside the vascular bundle, intrafascicular cambium. In between the two vascular bundles, interfascicular cambium. Protoderm, this also we know, isn't it? Protoderm region, epidermal region. Next, what is calyptrogen? This we doesn't know, and dermatogen. Dermatogen now, we have got the information in this question, isn't it? It is the outermost primary meristem of a plant. Okay, so region of the stem which is produced by apical meristem and give rise to unseriated epidermis. Okay, monocotyledon have one additional histogen along with the dermatogen, cerebellum and pleura. Calyptrogen being the fourth one that makes the root cap. Here, in the last question, we have the three options, but calyptrogen is the fourth one which involves in the formation of root cap. Okay, so this is found in case of monocots, extra calyptrogen. So, which is the correct option here? In monocot, root cap is formed from calyptrogen, option A. Again, there is a mistake here. Okay, correct option is calyptrogen. Tick for the option A. Okay, next, the functional xylem of an old dicot is, the functional xylem of an old dicot tree is alburnum, duramen, heartwood, atom. Okay, so alburnum, the function of conduction of water and dissolved minerals from roots is now performed by outer younger rings of the secondary xylem is called as what? Sapwood or alburnum. Okay, see here. So both options are same here. Duramen, nothing but heartwood. Okay, autumn wood, the wood which develops in the autumn season is called as autumn wood or late. Late wood, it is also called as what? Late wood. Okay, clear. So the functional xylem of an old dicot tree is nothing but what? Alburnum, which involves in the conduction of water and dissolved minerals. That's why the name functional xylem. Okay, functional means what? Involves in the conduction of water and minerals. Clear? Next, which among the following is not a part of periderm? So I've told you now itself while discussing the synapses, isn't it? Introduction part. So the periderm constitute what? Cork or phellem. Next, cork cambium or phellogen. Secondary cortex or phellem, cork or phellem, cork cambium or phellogen, secondary cortex or phelloderm. Okay, so which does not constitute this root. All the three together called as a periderm, but not the root. Okay, so that's why wood is the correct option. And I have given the detailed explanation. What is periderm? What is phellogen? What is carp? What is secondary cortex or phellodermis? Okay, so you can take a screenshot of this if you need. Clear? So which is the correct option for question number 21? D. Wood. Next, the function of cork cambium is to produce only cork, only secondary cortex, only cambium, both cork and secondary cortex. The function of cork cambium is to produce. Okay, cork cambium is a lateral meristem and is responsible for secondary growth that replaces the epidermis in root and stem. The function of cork cambium is to produce the cork, a tough protective material. So, the another name for the cork is what? Cambium, pericambium or phellogen. We will call it as what? Cork cambium or bark cambium or pericambium or phellogen. Okay, the correct option is only cork. The function, main function. Of course, it also, cork cambium also involves in the formation of secondary cortex or phellogen, isn't it? Okay, the main function is it produces the cork, which is also called as what? Cork cambium, bark cambium, pericambium and phellogen. Okay, next. The pith is small or absent in monocot root, dicot root, monocot stem, dicot stem. So pith is small in case of dicot stem, but if it is large in case of monocot root and dicot root. In case of monocot stem, pith is well developed in dicot stem, whereas in monocots it is absent. Why? Because in monocot stem we can see the formation of scattered vascular bundles in throughout the ground tissue. Okay, so there is no differentiation of cortex, endodermis, pith and all. So that's why pith is absent in case of monocots, present in case of dicot stem. It is well developed in case of dicot stem, it is absent in case of monocot stem. Is that clear? Okay. So, which is the correct option here? Monocot stem, option C. Next, question number 4. A dorsiventral leaf is identified by the presence of stomata on both the epidermis, stomata on upper epidermis, only on lower epidermis, no stomata on epidermis. So, we know it is the characteristic feature of dorsiventral leaf, that is, stomata is found on both the epidermis. Okay. So, that's why which is the correct option for question number 24A, option A. Next, a dicot root can be identified by exarch vascular bundles, endarch vascular bundle, presence of numerous xylem bundle, presence of large pith in dicot root. Okay, so which is the correct option here? Exarch vascular bundle. What is meant by exarch? We have already discussed what is exarch, what is it? Isn't it? If protoxylem is facing towards pith and metaxylem is facing towards periphery, then it is called as endarch. Exarch means protoxylem towards periphery, metaxylem towards the pith. In dicot root, it is a characteristic feature in the tetrarch vascular bundles among them. Metaxylem are facing towards pith, protoxylem are facing towards periphery. So that's why which is the correct option here? Exarch vascular bundle. Clear? Oh. Next, which of the following are undifferentiated actively dividing cells? Which of the following are undifferentiated actively dividing cells? Parenchyma, colenchyma, sclerenchyma, meristem. We know actively dividing cells is a characteristic feature of meristematic cells, isn't it? Because all these three are simple permanent tissue which lack the capacity of division. And this is the one which is having the capacity to divide. So that's why undifferentiated actively dividing cells is the meristematic cells. Okay. Next, question number 26D, option D. Which of the following is an example of lateral meristem? Pith, cambium, xylem, cortex. Cambium, we know that. So secondary cortex or secondary growth will involve on the meristematic tissue of the cambium. okay, so which is an example for lateral meristem, which is present in the sides of the part of the plant, involves an increase in the girth of the plant. So that's why, which is the correct option here? Cambium, which is also called as what? Phellogen. Okay, how many types of cambium are there? Fascicular, vascular cambium, interfascicular cambium, cork cambium is an example for lateral meristem. Next, which is responsible for the production of secondary tissue during secondary growth in dicot stem. Next, the region in apicals. Why it is moving so fastly? Okay, it's okay, no problem. The region in apical meristem develops into. The region in apical meristem develops into endodermis, pericycle, epidermis, vascular tissue. We know that which is the correct option for this question, vascular tissue, because the region in the apical meristem develops into vascular tissue. Okay, apical meristem involves in the development of this vascular tissue. So that's why which is the correct option for the question number 28, option D. Next, question number 29, hydatids or components of. Okay, vascular tissue system, ground tissue system, epidermal tissue system, cortex tissues. So first of all, we have to know what is hydatid means. So what are either hydatids? A hydatid is a type of pore commonly found in angiosperms that secrete water through pores in the epidermis or leaf margin. As we know, stoma involves in the removing of waste water or excess of water. But in some of the angiosperm, we can also see a small pore-like structure which develops on the epidermis or on the leaf margin, which also involves in the removal of waste products or secretes water through outside through pores. So these cells open out into one or more subepidermal chambers. Okay. So such cells are called as hydatids, mainly found in epidermal tissue system, not in vascular, not in ground, and not in cortex region. These are present in the epidermal tissue system. Okay, so that's why question number 29, which is the correct option C, epidermal tissue system is the correct option. Next, question number 30, which of the following is a living structure? Sclerenchyma, parenchyma, xylem, vessel, tracheus. We all know that sclerenchyma is a dead mechanical tissue, parenchyma is a living, simple living tissue. Xylem vessel is also dead cells found in the structure of the xylem. Tracheids are also cells of the xylem tissue. Okay, so that's why which is the one living structure here, parenchyma. Clear? Okay, next. In colenchyma, the thickening of the corners is made of. We know that the cell wall of colenchyma tissues are made up of cellulose, hemicellulose, and pectin. Whereas the pectin is deposited more thickly or the especially at the corners rather than the entire cell. Okay, so that's why corners pectin deposition is seen in the corner, not lignin, suberin, or resin. Clear? Okay. So here. Next, question number 32. This is an incorrect statement in contest of hardwood, which has been asked in the NEET in 2017. Okay, which among these four statement, which is an incorrect statement in contest of hardwood regarding the hardwood? Okay, so organic compounds are deposited in, comprises dead elements with highly lignified walls. It conducts water and minerals efficiently. It is highly durable. Except C, all the three are relevant to hardwood. But C is not relevant point regarding the hardwood, because the region of the stem that contains dead elements with highly lignified walls are called hardwood. It does not conduct water and minerals. So that's why option C is the correct option for question number 32. So the tissue or the cells which involves a wood, which involves in the conduction of water and minerals, so is the sapwood, isn't it? Sapwood or alburnum, not the heartwood or duramen. Okay, so that's why option C is the correct option. Next, The vascular cambium typically give rise to, which is also asked in the question, 2017. Is that clear? Next, the vascular cambium typically give rise to phloderm, secondary xylem, periderm, primary phloem. Okay, which is the correct option? Secondary xylem. During secondary growth, vascular cambium give rise to secondary xylem and secondary phloem. Whereas cork cambium give rise to primary phloem and primary xylem. Okay, so see here, secondary xylem. Phloderm is formed by cork cambium. Clear? So which is the correct option? Secondary xylem. Next, question number 34. The balloon shaped structure called tylosis. Okay, or what? The balloon shaped structure called tylosis or what? As in the NEET 2016. Okay, these are linked to the ascent of sap through xylem vessels or extension of xylem parenchyma cells into vessels, characterization of the presence of sap would originate in the lumen of vessels. So the correct option here is, these are the extension of xylem parenchyma cells into vessels. Okay, so see here, these are the balloon shaped extension of xylem parenchyma cells of vessels in the heart. So these structures are mostly found in drought exposed plants or in infected plants, wherein they serve to reduce the surface available for transport in the conducting element and thereby acting as a morphological defense. So that's why, which is the correct option here? Tylosis or balloon shaped extension of xylem parenchyma. Okay, is that clear? Next, question number 35. You have given a fairly old piece of dicot stem and a dicot root. Which of the following anatomical structure will use to distinguish between the two? So what we will select? Cortic cells or protoxylem or secondary phloem or secondary xylem. So according to the options, we are going to select protoxylem. But why? Not why cortical cells, what say, why secondary phloem or why secondary xylem. So here is the explanation why we have to select this protoxylem, because anatomically fairly old dicotyledonous root is distinguished from the dicotyledonous stem by position of protoxylem. Okay, we can able to distinguish the root and stem of dicot plants by looking the position of this protoxylem. In dicot root, the protoxylem is located near the periphery of the vascular cylinder. While in dicot stem, the protoxylem is located near the center of the vascular bud. That's why the xylem is called as what? Ender. Okay. So this is how we can differentiate the dicot stem and a dicot root by the presence of a protoxylem. Okay. Clear? So which is the correct option? Protoxylem. It has been asked in the 2014 year. Neat question. Okay. Next, 36. This is an incorrect statement for stromatal operators. Guard cells are always surrounded by subsidiary cells. Stomata are involved in gaseous exchange. Inner wall of guard cells are thick. Guard cells invariably possess chloroplast and mitochondria. See, by looking at the statements, all the statements are correct only, isn't it? Guard cells are surrounding by subsidiary cell itself. Stomata involved in gaseous exchange, of course it is correct answer. Inner wall of guard cells are thick, isn't it? Of course, right. Guard cells are invariably possess chloroplast. But if we look the options very carefully, see, guard cells are always surrounded by subsidiary cells is incorrect. Why? Here's the explanation. Sometimes the few epidermal cells in the vicinity of the guard cells become specialized in their shape and size and are known as subsidiary cells. Because usually guard cells are surrounded by epidermal cells. Okay. But the vicinity of the guard cells by opening, closing and the pressure exerting by the guard cells on the epidermal cells, this big make the epidermal cells to change in their shape and size, and they get converted as what? Subsidiary cells. Okay, so that's why, which is the correct option for question number 36 here. Guard cells are always surrounded by subsidiary cells. Yeah, okay. Option A. Next, 37. Some vascular bundles are described as open because it has been asked in the NEET mains 2011. Is this finished? No. Okay. So they are not surrounded by pericycle. They possess conjunctive tissue between xylem and phloem. Are surrounded by pericycle, but no epidermis. So no endodermis. And are capable of producing secondary xylem and phloem. Okay, so which is the correct option in case of vascular bundles are described as open? Open type of vascular bundles have cambium in between the xylem and phloem. Okay, so this produces both secondary xylem and secondary phloem. Next, the innermost region formed by the vascular cambium forms a secondary xylem, which is more in number, whereas outermost region, which is formed by the towards the epidermis, is called secondary phloem, which is fewer in its number. Okay, so that's why which is the correct option here. They are capable of producing secondary xylem and phloem. Is that clear? Okay. Next, 38. Heartwood differs from sapwood in. Heartwood differs from sapwood in asked in 2010, being susceptible to pathogens and pet, having dead and non-conducting elements, presence of fibers and rays, absence of vessels and parenchyma. Of course, having dead and non-conducting elements, isn't it? Heartwood or having dead and non-conducting elements, sapwood or having living and conducting functional xylem elements. So that is the difference between heartwood and sapwood. And here is the explanation for this. Clear? Okay. Option B is the correct answer for the question number 38. Next, the length of the different internodes in a clump of sugar cane is variable because of, it has been 2008. Okay. Position of axillary bud, shoot apical meristem, intercalary meristem, size of leaf lamina at the node below the each inter. Correct option is what? Intercalary meristem. The length of different internodes on a culm of sugar cane is variable because of the intercalary meristem. Intercalary meristem involves an increase in the length of the plants, which is found in between the harder part, that is nodal part. Okay, so nodal part kelagade iruttala internodal region alli baruvanta meristematic tissue nanantha karithivi intercalary meristem. Okay, so this involves in the production of length of different internodes. Okay, so that's why which is the correct option, intercalary meristem. Here is the reason, you can go through this. Okay, next. Question number 40. The cuticle is always present on the surface of root, leaf, stem, leaf and stem. We know that cuticle is found in both leaf and stem, which is a protective film covering epidermis of the leaves and younger shoots and other aerial part plant organs without periderm. Okay. So it's consisting of lipid and hydrocarbous polymers impregnated with wax and is synthesized exclusively by the epidermal cells. So which is the correct option for question number 40? That is leaf and stem bone. It found on the stem and leaf bone. Okay. So here these are the questions, certain questions regarding the anatomy of the flowering. Okay, so go through some other questions like this. I've selected different questions on all the concepts of the chapter and some of the concept which is not there in the chapter also. Okay, so then it will become easy for answering the more questions. Clear? Oh, thank you.